begins. So we lost an hour, allegedly. But to be honest, I'm happy for the longer days. I like it when it's sunny for longer. There's so much stuff to do. It's fun to go out and see all the beautiful nature that God has made and the sunset. It's a lot of fun. And, you know, even though you might feel a little tired, that's okay. Because today is a good day.
Yes.
And it's a Sunday, so you're not working and you can rest in a little bit. But today we're going to give God some praise and we're going to sing of his goodness and his mercies in a time that is insane and is crazy and it seems like we don't know what's going on. The reality is we don't know what's going on, but we don't have to know what's going on.
God knows.
God knows what's going on and God's got us. Amen?
There you go.
Amen. All right. So with that being said, go ahead and stand up wherever you are and get ready to give God some praise.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah, Lord. Oh, bless your name.
See the King of Glory.
you this morning, Father. Lord, we lift your name up on high this morning. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise today. We thank you that this is the day that you have made. Lord, we're grateful to be in your house again, to be able to worship you this morning, to lift up your name once again. As we come before the Lord this morning, we have several prayer requests this morning, and I'm going to continue to pray for the families of those who have lost loved ones, the Cisternos family and the Johnsons, the Nelsons, for Pastor Song's family in Cameroon, they burying his brother this week, for Yvonne's family this morning. We're continuing to pray for them this morning. And my friend Todd, that was with us back on Easter of last year, his sister's back in the hospital, and they've got her on a feeding tube this morning. So asking us to pray for her this morning. Kim, you'll remember she was with us in that service as well. So we're standing in the gap this morning. Continue to pray for those who are confined and those who are dealing with legal issues right now. So we lift up these needs. We lift up these requests before the Lord. And let's just bow our hearts right now. Father God, we praise you and we thank you, God, that you are the power, you are the glory, the lifter of our heads this morning. We thank you, God, that every answer is in your hand this morning, Lord God. Every yes and every amen is in you this morning, Lord God. And Lord, we lift up all these needs, these families, Lord God. We lift up our sister right now, my brother Todd right now. Lord, we just lift them before you right now. Send strength and comfort and peace, we pray this morning. God, for those that are in conflict this morning, those that are on the battlefields this morning, Lord, put a hedge of protection around them, we ask. Lord, that you'll seal up families, Lord God, and that you'll stop the hand of the enemy this morning in every land, Lord God. Lord, let there just be a day of peace, we pray, a time of rest for your people, we ask, Lord. This is the day that you have made, God. Be glorified in it, we pray. Be exalted here, we ask, Lord. Be exalted, we pray. In the name of Jesus, God's people said amen and amen as we continue to worship.
Oh,
Your name this morning. Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah. Come on, let's praise the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. Bless his great high name. Let us experience the glory of his presence this morning. We need to be aware that Jesus is in here this morning. Amen. Maybe you just came in just a little bit ago. Let me tell you, Jesus is here this morning. Amen. Whatever you need, Jesus is right here this morning. He's here for us today. He's here to meet us in our needs this morning. Maybe you're at home this morning. He's right there in your living room, right there in your kitchen, wherever you're watching us at. Jesus is there with you this morning. Let's go ahead and stand this morning. We're going to make our declarations. We do this. We've been doing this since the first of the year. And because we are God's people this morning. Everybody say that you're God's people this morning. Amen?
Yes.
We're God's people. Declaration number one. Through the blood of Jesus,
all my sins are forgiven.
Amen. Declaration number two.
My body
is a temple of the Holy Spirit.
Redeemed.
Cleansed.
By the blood of Jesus.
Bless his name this morning.
Yes.
Declaration number three.
Satan
has no place in me.
No power over me.
No unsettled claims against me.
All has been settled.
By the blood of Jesus.
By the blood of Jesus.
Touch your neighbor and say, morning, Cleveland.
Morning, Cleveland.
Number four, my members. The parts of my body.
The parts of my body.
Are instruments of righteousness. Yielded to God. For his service and glory. Amen. Amen. Look at somebody. You're looking good this morning out there.
Amen.
And number five.
I have received
the spirit of sonship.
And by him,
I cry.
Abba, Father.
Okay, something going on with my video up here, huh? Let's see if we can get it back. Praise God. Amen. Let's see, my PowerPoint's disappeared up there on the screen. Those folks at home probably have one up there. Let's get your Bibles this morning. Go with me to Matthew chapter 5.
Yes.
Praise God. Some technical interruptions up there, but we're not going to let that slow us down. Amen?
Amen.
We have the word this morning. We've been going through looking at these obstacles that we have in our lives. We got many obstacles that we face on the road of this life that we live. Many challenges. Okay, not coming back up. Let's see. That's all right. We're going to move on. Matthew chapter 5. You've got your Bibles. Let me put my glasses on here this morning so I can see the word. I need to see the word, amen?
Amen.
No, we need to see the word.
Amen.
You don't need to hear Pastor Lou's word. You need the word, amen?
Amen.
We're going to start at verse 20, the Beatitudes. Jesus says, for I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. And then he says this in verse 21. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder. And whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whoever says, you fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. That's why in my house we never call anybody a fool. How many of you know that this morning? We should not be calling anybody a fool today. There are some foolish people out there. They do some foolish things. We all know that. But that doesn't make them fools, amen? You know, we're dealing with the issues of these roadblocks that we have in life. The obstacles in our road we've looked at over the past few weeks have been sickness and loneliness. And then we looked at the issue, we've been looking at these issues. This morning we're dealing with anger.
Can I tell you that many, many people, many of God's people have been sidetracked by this. Yeah. We've been stuck off the road. It's kind of like we got this off-road experience. Some of you have been off track for a long time because of anger. And I want everybody in the sound of my voice to pay close attention to what I have to say this morning, because I have a lot to say to you about it. Americans are angry. We've been angry for the last couple of years. We've been angry over a lot of different stuff. We've been angry because of the George Floyd being kneeled on. We've been angry because of COVID. We've been angry because we've been told to wear a mask. We've been angry because we're told not to wear a mask. We've been angry because we're told to get a shot that didn't work. We've been angry about a lot of different things. And we should be angry. You should be angry at the right things, amen? The Bible tells us that we're to be angry and sin not. There is a way to be angry in God's book, amen? There's a way that God has given us to be angry. But we don't need to be angry with one another. And that's our problem this morning. We get angry with each other. People can't talk to their neighbors. Families can't talk to each other because they didn't vote for the right guy, or they didn't choose the right one, or because they stand for this or they stand for that. And it's time for us to get those rocks out of the road this morning. Amen?
Yes.
Let me tell you something. Anger has sidetracked many people this morning. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes 7, verse 9, control your temper, for anger labels you a fool. Listen to that. Control your temper, for anger labels you a fool. David said in Psalm 37, verse 8, cease from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. You know, Ralph Waldo Emerson, I made some additional notes this morning, so I got to go through and tell you about these. But he says, listen to this quote by Emerson. He said, for every minute you remain angry, you give up 60 seconds of peace of mind. Think about that. Every minute that you remain angry, you give up 60 seconds of peace of mind. We're supposed to be a people of peace, amen? God's people are people of peace this morning.
Yeah.
Now, what is anger? Anger is all around us. What is human anger? Anger is an emotional disturbance, a soulish action. It begins in here. It's not something this outside deals with. It's something that starts in here. Anger comes from a feeling of being injured or insulted. It's a vexation. It's a resentment. We resent people telling us what to do. We resent our parents telling us what to do, how to act. Well, they don't know. They don't understand me. And so we get angry about these things. Anger causes distress and hostility. Anger is a negative and a depressive emotion. Anger is a danger to society. And we see its effects all around us this morning. One lady made this note. She said, I am a danger to myself if I get angry. How many of you can say amen to that? I know I've been an angry. Anytime I get angry, I'm a danger to myself. You know, what is the source of our anger? Well, the words are key about stirring up anger this morning, aren't they? The things we say, how we say them to people, our inflection on how we speak to people. Well, why are you so angry? Well, why did you say to talk to me that way? And so we get all upset and we get angry with those poor people. Why? Because we hear things that that aren't being said sometimes. How many of you know that a lot of times people are speaking, but you're not hearing what they're saying?
Right.
And that seems to be the biggest problem I find in life, is that we speak, but sometimes people don't hear what we have to say. Proverbs 15, verse 1 says, a soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger.
Yes.
Will Rogers had this statement to say. He said, never miss a good chance to shut up. And I like that one. Never miss a good chance to shut up. Amen? Somebody said this. They said, speak when you're angry, and you'll make the best speech you'll ever regret. And I've done that many a time. So I'm talking from experience here this morning. I'm not talking to you about something I don't know about. Amen? When I talk about, we're talking about anger, all of us have dealt with this, and all of us deal with this. And all of us need to get ourselves in check this morning, amen? This is a rock that's in the road that we need to get out of the road this morning. Jealousy becomes anger. Proverbs 27, verse 4 says, wrath is cruel and anger a torrent, but who is able to stand before jealousy? Jealousy causes anger. We get upset because Joe got a bigger piece of pie than I did, or because somebody got the promotion that I should have got, or because, you know, I perceive that somebody's done me wrong. Listen, we need to get our emotions in check this morning, amen? Pride becomes anger, doesn't it? The Bible says in Proverbs 13, verse 10, by pride comes nothing but strife, but the well-advised is wisdom. But with the well-advised is wisdom. Pride is our central course of anger, because Captain I is in charge here. It's my way or the highway. This is my house. We're going to do it my way. How many of you know that everything we have belongs to God this morning?
Amen.
When we start putting I in front of it, you know, we need to check ourselves. We're on our way to a fall. In fact, that's what the scripture says, doesn't it, right there? It says pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. That's a warning to us this morning, isn't it? Psalm 73 verse 6 says, therefore pride serves as their necklace. Violence covers them like a garment. Let me give you one more thing that causes anger this morning. Uncontrolled temper. Not checking ourselves. Not checking ourselves. Uncontrolled temper. When one is not pleased with people, things, or circumstances, it becomes anger in us. A quick-tempered man acts foolishly, the Bible says, and a man of wicked intentions is hated. Anger is as old as the Bible itself. How many of you know that this morning? Anger has been around since Cain and Abel. The first act of anger, the first outburst of anger, was when Cain slew his brother Abel. The Bible says in Genesis 4, verses 5 through 8, but unto Cain and to his offering, he had not respect. God rejected Cain's offering. Why? Because he didn't bring it from the first fruits. He didn't come with everything that he should have came with. Here's the thing. We're supposed to bring God the best. Amen? Yeah. The best of everything that we are, the best of everything we have. Yeah. You're supposed to offer it to God first. And Cain didn't do that. And so God rejected Cain's offering. And the Bible says, but unto Cain and to his offering, he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth. That means he was angry. And his countenance fell. Verse 6 says, and the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth? Why are you mad? That's what God is saying to him. And why is thy countenance fallen? Verse 7 says this, if thou doest well, shalt not thou be accepted. And then he said, and if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door. And its desire is to rule over you. I'm going to tell you this morning, church, this is key for us. Sin lies at the door. Every time you go in and out of the door, just think about that. Sin's waiting at the other side for you. This morning when you got up and you drove out the house, you thought you were just going to church. But I'm telling you, the devil was outside waiting for you. And this evening when you get back home, the devil's going to be inside waiting for you there. So you got to watch what you say, amen. Watch how we act. Watch how we conduct ourselves. Check ourselves this morning. Amen? Cain didn't check himself. And the result was in verse 8 that he rose up and he slew his brother. Took his life. And the blood of that man cried out from the ground. It was a religious move. Cain was upset because of religion. How many of you know that? The church has been fighting battles. We fight against the Baptists, fight the Methodists, and the Methodists fight the Catholics. The Catholics want to fight the Presbyterians. The Presbyterians want to fight the Pentecostals. Everybody wants to disagree with everybody. Nobody's got a lock on this thing. Not Baptist, Catholic, Methodist, amen. Presbyterian. None of them have a lock on this thing. The only one that has a lock on us this morning should be Jesus.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
What will anger do to us? What will anger produce? The effects of anger. See that time bomb in that guy's head? Waiting to go off. Let me share with you some of the physical effects of anger. Anger triggers the body's fight or flight response. Other emotions that trigger this response include fear, excitement, and anxiety. The adrenal glands flood the body with stress hormones such as adrenaline and cortisol. The brain shunts blood away from the gut and towards the muscles in preparation for physical exertion. Heart rate, blood pressure, respiration increase. The body temperature rises and the skin perspires. The mind is sharpened and focused. That's what happens when you get mad. That's why you feel keenly aware. That's why you're emotional. Everything, you feel the heat. You feel the heat, don't you? You know? We feel the heat. I felt the heat many a time. You know, I grew up, I was an angry person. I'm still angry to this day. God help me to check myself this morning. Amen? I'm preaching to myself this morning. I studied this word, preached this word, and brought this word to myself all week long this week, church. Let me tell you something. But anger can blind our mind to reason. How many of you know that this morning?
Right.
Things that should make common sense don't even make sense when you're mad. Proverbs 27 verse 4 says, wrath is cruel and anger is outrageous, but who is able to stand before envy? Number two, anger demands retaliation. Anger demands retaliation. In 2 Samuel, we have the story of Ammon who raped his sister Tamar. These were David's children. And her brother Absalom gets upset. And because David didn't do anything, because dad didn't check him like he should have, Absalom said, I'll take care of this. And his anger arose, and he slew his brother. And righteously so. I mean, that's, if you're going to get mad about something, that's a good reason to get mad. Somebody's attacking your family, somebody's hurting your family, that's a good reason to get upset. But this is what anger does. Anger demands retaliation. Anger demands that I get the pay. What is that James Brown saying? The big payback? That's where it's at. You know? We want to pay back everybody. I'll pay you back. You wait and see. I'm going to get you. And that's what happens with anger. Anger can make a person physically ill. Listen to these health problems that come from anger. The constant flood of stress chemicals and associated metabolic changes that go with ongoing unmanaged anger can eventually cause harm to many different systems of the body. Some of the short and long-term health problems that have been linked to unmanaged anger include headaches, digestion problems such as abdominal pain, insomnia, increased anxiety, depression, high blood pressure, skin problems such as eczema, heart attacks, stroke, anger explosions. You know, these are what cause people to tip over the edge, fall off the wagon. Another thing anger does is it burns. Anger burns, church. It burns the person who's holding it. It burns the person it's touching. Anger is bad for us all. And God wants us to deal with our hearts this morning. He wants us to get ourselves in check this morning. Amen? Which brings me back to our scripture this morning. In Matthew 5, verse 20, where Jesus said, "For I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall in no case enter the kingdom of heaven." Jesus is telling the people here, when he begins this message, he begins to give them six outlines on the human heart. Six things that need to change in the human heart. Now, this is just number one that he begins to deal with. And the first thing he deals with is anger. This is the first thing he tells us we need to get our hearts in check with. Because he says, unless you guys are more right than the scribes and the Pharisees, and these guys were everything they tried to be. They walked upright, they paid their tithes, they always did this, they did the right things, they said the right things, but their hearts weren't right. You know, the story is given about King Tut, and I know you see his face up there on the board. You say, well, why does he have King Tut up here referring to Matthew? Well, let me give you a little background. Howard Carter discovered King Tut in a tomb in 1924. He found King Tut was buried in this large sarcophagus, this coffin. And this coffin that they buried him in consisted of three coffins. There was actually a coffin inside of a coffin inside of a coffin inside of a coffin. So I'm going to tell you why he's up there this morning. And let me move to the next slide here for you. Because there you can see the big sarcophagus. Some of you might have seen these pictures, you know, in your history classes and things like that. But what they did was when they opened up that first sarcophagus, they looked inside and they found another coffin that was overlaid with gold. Now notice these are all beautiful, beautiful structures, big gold things covered. The second coffin, they looked inside of that and there was another coffin overlaid with gold. They looked inside of that and there was another coffin that was made of solid gold. Solid gold. They looked inside of that and there was King Tut wrapped in a gold cloth and he had this gold mask on his face. But when they took the mask off of King Tut, when they unwrapped him and they removed that wrap, that gold cloth, you know what they found inside? A dead, shriveled up body. A bunch of dead, shriveled up bones. And that's what the Pharisees were like. That's what the Sadducees were like. That's what a lot of God's people are like today. Outside, we look good. I look clean. I got a nice pair of slacks on this morning. I got a good shirt on this morning. Oh, I smile and I say all the Christian right words. But inside, there's a seething dead body. There's stink inside of me. There's stink inside of you this morning when we allow anger to rule and reign. You hear what I'm telling you this morning? This is the problem. Outside, very beautiful. Inside, dead man's bones. Inside, dead stuff, putrefying stuff. And that's what Jesus is talking about when he says, unless your righteousness exceeds the scribes and the Pharisees, unless you're better than they are, you're not going to get into heaven. Now, these guys were they tried to be right about everything they did. You know what? Here's the thing about the scribes and the Pharisees. You know what the Pharisees did? That Jesus deals with them on several occasions in the scripture. I'm going to give you a couple of them this morning as we get through this because I have a lot of notes this morning. But one of the things he identified with them is that their heart wasn't right. He said, you guys, you tithe mint and rue. You tithe all this mint and stuff. You're willing to give God his tithe. And listen, the tithe belongs to God. I know we didn't take the offering, Pastor Keaton. I'm aware of that this morning. That's why I wanted to get to the message because I figured it might touch some folks. You know, y'all might feel a little bit guilty about this. But here's what the Pharisees would do. The Bible says in Matthew 23, Jesus said, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you pay tithe of mint and ants and cumin." Here's what they would do. You know mint leaves that we put in tea sometimes, or mint that you make mint juleps out of, or mint, you know. They would take a mint plant, and they would count the leaves on them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That one belongs to God. They would pull that mint leaf off, and they would put it in a pile for God. And then they'd count the next one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And every tenth, they would put in a container to make an offering to God. Now, think about that. Think of how in your house that if you, because we buy those flats of water, and there were 35 bottles on it. That means that every 3.5 bottles belong to God every time you buy a flat of water. Think about that. If every time you, everything you ever had, everything you get, you take a tenth of and you put it aside for the Lord. That's what really the tithe was about. That's what tithing is really all about. You know, somebody said, and I like this observation, because if the church was full of Pharisees today, here's what they look like. And they'll see there's six things up there on the board. First, they'd be here every Sunday. They'd be in church every Sunday. They would not miss a day. They're the Pharisees. Got to keep the law. They'd be on time. There'd be no late Christian, no late Pharisees coming in. They'd be all carrying their Bibles. They'd have the biggest Bible, and it'd be, you know, outfitted with the leaves and special gold embossation and everything else on it. They'd all be tithers, because that's what they do. They keep the law. Got to keep the law. They'd never curse, never swear, never drink or get drunk, never commit adultery. They wouldn't do any of those things, because that's against the law. But you know what they'd all be doing also? They'd all go to hell. They'd all go to hell because their hearts weren't right. And a lot of people come to church today. A lot of Christians that show up at church every morning, every Sunday morning, come in with their hearts wrong. And God's saying, get the heart right this morning. How many of you know that? How many of you know that God desires truth in the inward parts? He desires, David said in Psalm 51, verse 6, behold, you desire truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part, you will make me to know wisdom. Listen to that. God wants this to be true. And then he says, I'm going to reveal, when we get this true, guess what? I'll reveal some great things to you. Mm-hmm. The wisdom of God goes with those that want to walk in truth. Jesus said it this way in Luke 6, 45. He said, a good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good. And an evil man out of the evil treasure in his heart brings forth evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, he says, his mouth speaks. Yes. See, what's in us eventually always comes out. Whatever's going on inside here comes out through your lips. If you can throw around the curse words and the F's this and the blanks that very easily, guess what? That's what's in there. If you're a thief, if you're robbing folks, if you're comfortable stealing stuff and comfortable, being that way, that's what's in here. It's the stuff in here that Jesus is trying to deal with, amen? It's the stuff in here that he's trying to get right with us this morning. So it's what's inside that counts, not what's on the outside. And in the next two verses, Jesus begins to deal with the Pharisees. He begins to deal with the people on what's on the issue of anger. And I want you to see carefully what he's talking about here. He says, and this is what he says. He said, you have heard that it was said of them of old time, thou shalt not kill. That was the sixth commandment. Thou shalt not kill. Exodus 20, verse 13, you can find that there. And he says, whoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you that, this is what Jesus said, it's not just about murder, not just killing. But I say unto you that whosoever is angry, did you hear the word? Angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. Angry. He says it starts right there with our attitude. It starts right there with how we deal with each other, the anger. You know, we can't just have this expression, I'm God's man, I'm God's this, I'm God's that, I'm pastor so-and-so and this, but then I blow up at the waiter because my food is a little chilly. Or I flip the guy off on the freeway because he cut me off. Yo, that's not good, church. That's not good. We need to get ourselves under control this morning, amen? And you can't tell me that we can't, because if Jesus wouldn't have given us this instruction, if he didn't think we could keep it. How many of you know that this morning? And he says to them, listen, this is our problem this morning. We have this thing called the malice of anger. I call it up there on the board. The malice of anger. And I'm going to show you how this all ties together as we go through the word this morning. But see, his concern is not the outside. His concern is what's on the inside of us this morning.
Paul wrote about these same people when he said in Romans 10, verse 3, he said, they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. You see, God put in us the ability to do right this morning. If you're a child of God this morning, you have the Holy Spirit in you. And the Holy Spirit equips you and enables you to be able to walk upright, talk upright, live upright, act upright, think upright. You know, I like this. Somebody said this. They said, a man is not a sinner because he sins. He sins because he is a sinner. A man's not a thief because he steals. He steals because he's a thief. A man's not a liar because he tells lies. He tells lies because he's a liar. That's the weakness of the flesh, church. That's what we are. That's what we were before we got saved, amen? But we're no longer those people, amen? I'm no longer a thief. I'm no longer a liar. I'm no longer this person who walks about doing what's wrong, amen? I've now been received the Spirit of God. I've now received the influx of the Lord. And so we need to get these things in our heart correct this morning. The malice of murder, the malice of anger. That's what Jesus is dealing with here. You know, and listen, murder is not forbidden. How many of you know that all murder is not forbidden? But there are three types of murder that we're not supposed to be a part of. How many of you know that this morning? Three dynamics that I want you to see this morning. First of all, homicide is forbidden. It is forbidden for us to take another person's life just on our own, just because we feel like taking somebody's life, or because you want to be a gangbanger, because you think you can roll down the street and shoot up the street. That's homicide. That's murder. What they call it, was it a 186 or a 182 or whatever it is? 187, whatever it is. We don't need to be committing to 187s this morning, amen? God's people should not be engaged in 187s. God's people should not be engaged in suicide. How many of you know that this morning? Suicide is you taking your own life. And only God gave you that. We don't have the right to take our own lives this morning. I'm telling you right now. I know people commit suicide. I'm not condemning those. I'm not condemning it. But what I'm telling you is we don't have that right. The Lord said he'll make a way for us. Amen? There's no temptation that's overtaken us, but such as is common to man. And he said he will make a way for us to endure the temptation, to endure the situation, if we'll trust him. But so many times we don't want to trust him, and so we want to take the easy way out. And suicide is not, we have no right to do that. We have no right to kill babies. Infanticide. And we're doing that every day to the tune of 60,000 babies every year in this country. 60,000 babies every year aborted. Abortion is wrong. Abortion is wrong. And listen, let me tell you something. If they're okay killing babies, we ain't far off from them being okay killing old folks. Listen to what I'm telling you this morning. Because if they're willing to give you a shot to take that baby's life, they're willing to give you a shot because you're just a burden on them because of your age. So think about that this morning. But the Bible tells us that we are not to, that's all forms of murder. That's all form of malice in the heart. Now, the Bible does not forbid us for killing animals. I know there's a lot of people that think, well, you should be, but the Bible actually tells us that we should kill animals. How many of you know that? Exodus 20, verse 24, you'll read how the killing of animals is called for. And the Bible says this, it says, an altar of earth thou shalt make unto me and shalt sacrifice thereon thy burnt offerings and thy peace offerings, thy sheep, and thine oxen, in all places where I record my name, and I will come unto thee, and I will bless thee. The Lord is okay with us. I know we want to save the whales and kill the babies, but listen, we need to get this thing turned back around this morning. The Bible does not forbid capital punishment. Listen to what I'm telling you this morning. Somebody breaks in your house, the Bible says that you're supposed to take them out. How many of you know that this morning? If they break in your house under the cloak of darkness. Now listen, you think I'm okay. Turn with me, get your Bibles, go with me to Exodus 21. Exodus 21. No, I got to take you to the Word this morning. Remember, I don't want you to have Pastor Lou's Word. I want you to have the Word of God this morning. Amen? Exodus 21. And I want you to see verse 12 with me. And the Bible says this. It says, he who strikes a man so that he dies shall surely be put to death. He who strikes a man so that he dies shall surely be put to death. It's put right there in the Scripture. God's word says you kill somebody, your life's required. Now, you don't have we shouldn't just go out of our way to kill somebody. Even if a person breaks into your house, and the Bible warns us that if they break into our house under the cloak of darkness to do your family harm, you have every right to protect yourself. You have every right to take that person out. How many of you know that this morning? and you break into my house, I'll tell you what, God help you. You're going to need Jesus. I'm telling you right now. You're going to need Jesus. And I say that with the utmost respect and love for everyone. Don't break into folks' house. Don't be that person. Amen. The Bible tells us that we actually have, that's what the government's actually supposed to take care of these things. How many of you know that? Paul tells us in Romans 13, for the authorities do not strike fear in people who are doing right, but in those who are doing wrong. And would you like to live without the fear of the authorities? Do what is right, the Bible says, and they will honor you. The authorities are God's servants, sent for your good. But if you're doing wrong, of course you should be afraid, for they have the power to punish you. They are God's servants, sent for the very purpose of punishing those who do what is wrong. That's what the government's supposed to take care of. And when we want to defund the police and stop the police from doing their jobs, let me tell you something. We're holding up God's work, because they're supposed to be the ones out here keeping the streets safe for you and me. But we're out there. And I know there's bad police and there's good police. But listen, we need to sort the bad ones out and get to the good ones, but don't stop them from doing their job. Amen? The Bible tells us that we need to understand, we need to pray for those who rule over us. That's what we're called to do. Amen? So the Bible does not forbid these things. The Bible does not forbid you from killing in self-defense. Exodus 22, verses 2 through 3. Listen to this. If a thief is caught in the act of breaking into a house and is struck and killed in the process, the person who killed the thief is not guilty of murder. But if it happens at daylight, and the one who killed the thief is guilty of murder. So what the Bible is saying, if you see the guy coming, you know he's breaking into your house and you got a way to stop him. Don't just kill him. You know, don't just knock him off, all right? Don't let him stand. You know, you see him breaking in the door, and then you go shoot him on the front porch and drag him in. Don't do that, all right? Don't do that. The thief is guilty, but we have no right to take his life if he's busted. Amen. We need to turn him over to the law. Now, there's a type of killing in war, and soldiers that fight in a war, they're called to be on a battlefront. And so that's not, God does not stop that. But what he's talking about are just those three things, the homicide, the suicide, and the infanticide. That's murder. That's murder, and it begins in here. It begins in here. So next thing I want you to see is this, the acid of anger. The acid of anger. For out of the abundance of the heart, out of what's in here, church, that's what we need to check this morning, amen? That's what we're trying to get under control this morning. That's what the roadblock is. That's that big rock that's in the middle of the road this morning for so many of us. It's the acid of anger. Jesus has said, he said, you've heard it said, thou shalt not kill. The Pharisees were nodding their heads. They were shaking, yeah, we don't kill. I don't kill anybody. But then he goes on to tell them, and they're probably going, preacher, yeah, you getting them, Jesus, get them. You know? But then he says, but I say unto you, and you heard me say this earlier, but I say unto you, whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause. And for what reason should we be angry with our brothers? Is there any good reason that we should be angry with our brothers? We get angry, we do. The Bible tells us to be angry and sin not. Amen. I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself, but there is sometimes you get angry and you get upset. But he says, but I say unto you, whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause, did he break into your house? Did he steal your food? Did he take something that he shouldn't have taken? Did he hurt you? There's a reason to be angry. Did he hurt you? I'm not talking about your feelings either. Amen. Because see, that's why we get mad, because our feelings get hurt. But are your feelings more important than that person's life? And Jesus goes on to say, whosoever is angry with his in danger of the same judgment that comes down on the murderer, on the one that commits the 187, Jesus is saying is what's coming down on the one who's angry with his brother without a cause. He takes away our illusion of self-righteousness. You have no, you know, because we all, if truth be told, we all got something that we ought to be sitting back and saying, you know what, I did that person wrong, or I said this, and I, you know. We all said something to offend somebody sometime along the way. We've all done something to hurt and our words. Remember I said words, our jealousy, the things that we do. Rage, uncontrolled rage, those are the things that cause our anger. Story is given of a little boy who was doing his homework, and he asked his dad. He said, Dad, what causes people to go to war? Why do people kill each other in war? And the dad said, well, son, it's like this. If you want to know what causes war, he said, for example, in World War I, he said, Germany invaded Belgium. And his mother came in, and she was drying her hands. She was in the process of doing dishes. And she said, no, father, that's not the way it is. Here's the way that war started. And he said to her, look, do you want to, and then the dad said to the wife, do you want to answer the question, or do you want me to answer the question? Did he ask you, or did he ask me? Besides that, you don't know anything about it. Why don't you butt out of this conversation? Anybody ever heard those words before? Why don't you butt out of this conversation? And she said, what do you mean? I don't know anything about it, the wife said. She threw her dish towel on the floor, turned around, slammed the door, went back into the kitchen. You could hear her rattling the cabinets. And then he said, now, son, let me tell you how wars start. And the son looked at dad and he said, that's all right, I already know. You see, out of the abundance of what's in our heart, our words, simple words, a simple argument, that's how wars start. Where do wars come from, James says? It comes in here. It's the stuff going on inside of us. And you and I both know this morning there's some stuff in our hearts we need to check, amen? There are three types of anger that come out of the human heart. The first is caustic anger. That's what Jesus is talking about in Matthew 5:22. Somebody's done something to you. You feel offended. You feel wrong. I don't know what they said to you. I don't know what they did to you. I don't know what happened to you. Maybe what your daddy said to you 1,000 years ago. Maybe what mama didn't say to you. Maybe something somebody did to you when on a job a long time ago. But you've got this caustic anger, and it's like a corrosive acid. It's just bubbling away inside of you. And you begin to meditate and think on these things, and it's building up in you. And the caustic anger eventually turns into contemptuous anger. And that contemptuous anger is where Jesus is talking about that you say to your brother, Raka. You're calling him names. Now it's something bubbling up in you, and now you got to talk about, you're mumbling under your breath. That person that's so-and-so and so. And now that's what happens. That's what he's talking about here. It becomes a contemptuous. I have contempt for that person. I don't like that person anymore. I want to hurt that person. This is what he's talking about here. You know, it's funny because the Bible, the Bible scholars have no translation for the word raka. Somebody has said that it means this. It means worthless one, basically. It's a term of contempt. Worthless one. You have no value to me. I see no value in you. Whoever says to that one, raka, Jesus said. And then he goes on to talk about the next stage is that condemning anger. You fool. You're a fool. You a fool. And we throw that word out there quite a bit. Well, once our tempers are blown, once the bomb is lit, the fuse is lit, the bomb goes off, boom, in our heads. Next, we're calling each other names. We're calling everybody out of their personage and out of their lineage and everything else. We're calling them, and this is where racism comes from. Because we look at each other and we have contempt for one another, and we don't realize we're all God's people. Every single one of us has been made in the image of Almighty God. Every single one of us, black, white, brown, and yellow. And I have no reason to hate the black man, the white man, or the brown man any more than I hate myself. I love myself, to be honest with you. And I love you. That's what Jesus died for. Jesus didn't die for black folks only, or white folks only, or brown folks only. Jesus died for us all. All of us were sinners. All of us were tainted with the shame of sin. All of us were guilty, and he gave his life for all. And that's why he says, love one another. Love one another. But that bubbling anger, that caustic anger, turns into contemptuous anger, and then it becomes condemning anger. The Bible says in 1 John 3, verse 15, whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer, and ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. Do you hear that? Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. It begins in here. The malice of anger, it leads to murder. Somebody said this. They said, you can tell the size of a man by what makes him angry. That's a scary thought, isn't it? What makes you angry? You miss a putt on the golf course. Now you bend the club and you tear it up. Yeah. The wife says something to you. Now you're ready to bend her up and tear her up. But this is the facts. This is what goes on in us today, Lord, church. Lord, help us this morning to hear his word. The Bible says you can be angry without sinning. Be angry and sin not. You know, it's interesting in that passage that Paul gives us there in Ephesians 4. And I'm going to turn over there, and we're going to kind of go there for about the remainder of this message. And I'll be finishing up here very quickly here. I have, I think, another four slides for you. But let me share with you what the Scriptures say in Ephesians. If you want to turn with me, Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4, and we're going to verse 26. And listen to what Paul says. Be angry. That's a command, church, by the way. Be angry. You command it. You can be angry. God, you know how there's some things we need to be angry about. Amen? We need to be angry when people are hurting little kids. We need to be angry when we see sin just running rampant in the streets. We need to be angry about stuff when stuff's not done right. We need to be angry when they're trying to teach kids foolishness in the schools. We need to be angry about that. But we don't need to sin. We don't need to go burn the school down because we don't like what they're teaching. How many of you know that this morning? We don't need to off the teachers because we don't agree with what they're saying. Amen? Amen? All right. Be angry. And then he says, here's another command. And do not sin. That's another command. Don't sin. And he says, don't let the sun go down on your wrath. And that's a word for all of us as those that are married, those of us that have friends, in every relationship you have. Don't let the sun go down being mad about the same stuff. How many of you know that this morning? We need to check ourselves on that. Check yourself. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. Verse 30, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. This is key for us. Verse 31, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Remember I said we talked about the malice of murder earlier. So I'm going to show you how this works, how this anger affects us, how it progresses in us. And that's that passage we just read here. It's a progressive anger. That's what Paul is talking about here. That anger starts with bitterness. It starts that bitterness. You know, that I got something against you. I don't like what you said. I don't like how you treated me. I don't like the way you looked at me. It's a feeling of resentment that settles down on the inside. And what happens is bitterness soon becomes wrath. Now I want to take action against you because I don't like what you said. I have to retaliate. Your word against my word. It's you against me. And so now wrath comes from a Greek word that means to burn. It means that you're doing a slow burn on the inside. You ever felt that? I know I felt it a few times. You know, somebody said something to me, and now I'm beginning to churn and burn. You know, Jocelyn, that's what I'm talking about here. I'm beginning to think, and that steam is starting to come out of my ears, you know. And then it becomes anger. Then, eventually that wrath becomes anger. Now I'm going to be expressing it with my words. Now I got something to say to you. Now I got to give you what for, tell you all about it. And that's the picture here. It's a progressive stage. And what comes out of our mouth, fiery words, things that burn, things that hurt, just flying off the handle. And that eventually turns into clamor. You see, because the devil, he's not done with us when he just gets us mad and we just said a few things, you know. Now you've said some things. Now you got to do something. Now you got to, that word clamor. And the clamor means it's loud talking. Now I got to raise my voice. Now I got to get real loud with you. I'm louder than you and I'm better than you. And that's what happens, church. And don't look at me funny this morning because I know some of y'all, and I've seen you go that way. Yep. And then that clamor becomes evil speaking because we're not done yet. That's where we get to the raka, and you fool. We start calling each other names. We start putting each other down. We start hurting each other with our words. And now I've got nothing nice to say about that person. I'm going to hate that person forever. And then that eventually becomes malice. And malice is murder. Malice is murder, church. We've come full circle. Why? Because we're angry. And that's what Jesus is talking about in that passage. You know, the human life, we are bottomless cups. We are what we continue to pour in. You can never fill us up. We can never be full until we're full of the Holy Spirit. How many of you know that? We are like bottomless cups. And that's what, when the Lord says, except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no case enter the kingdom of heaven. You know, unless we get right this morning, unless we get it right, you know, we're no better than they are. We're like that, we're like King Tut. We're like King Tut. I'm just about there. So I'm going to try to get you into heaven this morning. How many of you know that? I'm going to help you to turn off the stove. Amen? I like this slide. I put this one up there with the guy's stove burning up. And I thought about Pastor Jack when I made this slide because her stove catching fire the other week. I said, this would be a great illustration here. Because how many of you know we cannot behave our way into heaven? I can't be good enough to get to heaven. I can't pay tithes and get to heaven. That doesn't get me to heaven. You know, the only way I can get to heaven this morning is by receiving. First of all, I got to receive the Holy Spirit. Amen. I got to receive Jesus. Unless we're saved, unless you're born again, you can't control your anger. You're just you might say, well, I keep myself in check. Yeah, but you know what? You need the Holy Ghost. How many of you know that this morning? The only way you get the Holy Ghost is through Jesus this morning. Amen. So you've got to get out of the flesh. Romans 8 verse 9 says, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Unless you're born again, unless you are a child of God this morning, you don't have the Spirit of Christ. And so I invite you this morning, the first thing you need to do is get saved. The next thing we're going to do is we need to understand that God puts his rights. When we receive Jesus, we receive what's called imputed righteousness. Imputed righteousness means that you couldn't pay your bill. You couldn't do what was right. So Jesus came along and put it in you. He paid it on your behalf. Amen. He did what we could not do. He did what we could not do, church. And when I talk about imputed righteousness, I'm talking about the fact that God's righteousness is put in us. That Jesus died, he paid our sin debt, he did everything that we couldn't do for ourselves. The second thing we need to understand is that we have an implanted righteousness. He didn't just pay our bill, but then he puts us in us, the Holy Ghost, which gives us the ability to do what's right. Now I have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit checks me all. You know, and how many of you ever, you got mad and then the Holy Spirit was telling you, just zip it, zip it, zip it, but you kept on going. We've got to stop ignoring the Spirit. How do you do that? You build the Spirit man up. You got to build the Spirit man up. You can't just keep putting in you can't sit down at the table and keep eating that big steak and expect to be full of the Holy Ghost. You're going to be full of something, but it ain't going to be the Holy Ghost. You know, I heard the story about this some lion that came out of the jungle and ate up a whole bull and then somebody, anyway, I better not tell you that story. It was about it says you got to be careful when you fill up on bull. So anyway, I'll leave it like that. But let me give you one other thing too. You need to forgive easily and quickly. As God's people, we need to let some stuff go. Amen. Psalm 37 verses 7-9. Tells us this. It says, be still in the presence of the Lord and wait patiently for him to act. Don't worry about evil people who prosper or fret about their wicked schemes. Stop being angry. Turn from rage. Do not lose your temper. It only leads to harm. For the wicked will be destroyed, but those who trust in the Lord will possess the land. We need to check ourselves. Amen. Before we wreck ourselves. Jesus goes on to say in Matthew 5, he says this, agree with thine adversary quickly, whilst thou art on the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be cast into prison. Verily I say unto thee, thou shalt by no means come out thence till thou hast paid the utmost farthing. We need to understand that waiting on God produces serenity. It brings us to a place of peace. And that's a word that we don't hear much about anymore, serenity. But we all need some serenity this morning, amen? We need to rest in the Lord. That's what David says. Rest in the Lord. Be still in the presence of the Lord. Rest in him this morning. Amen? If you're angry about something, you're angry with somebody, we need to let it go. Move the rock out of the road this morning. Amen? You have no reason to be angry with anyone other than yourself. Other than yourself. Let me close with this very quickly here. A man dreamed of the gates of heaven, And there were people who were trying to get into heaven. Someone knocked at the gate of heaven, and a voice from within said, "Who is it that seeks entrance into heaven? And what is the password?" And the man at the pearly gate said, "I am a righteous man, a moral man." And he said, "What is the password into heaven?" And he said, "Honesty." And the voice from within said, "Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I never knew you." Another knocked at the gate of heaven, and the voice said within him, within said, "Who is it that seeks entrance into heaven? And what is the password into heaven?" And the one at the gate said, "I'm a religious man." And he said, "What is the password into heaven?" And he said, "Ritual and religion." And the voice within said, "Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I never knew you." Another knocked at the pearly gate, and the voice within said, "Who is it that seeks entrance to heaven? And what is the password?" And this man said, "I'm a humanitarian." And he said, "What is the password into heaven?" And he said, "Love and charity." And the voice within said, "Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I never knew you." At last there came one other, and he knocked at the gate. And the voice within said, "Who is it that seeks entrance into heaven? And what is the password?" And this man said, "In my hand no price I bring. Simply to thy cross I cling." And the voice within said, "Open wide the gate, and let him in, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." Listen, you can't control yourself, but the Holy Ghost will, if you allow him. You understand that? If we allow the Holy Ghost to rise up in us, if we'll fill ourselves up on the Word of God, if we'll feed the Spirit that's in us, feed the Spirit man. Stop feeding the flesh man. Flesh man wants to eat. He wants to say what he wants to say. He wants to do what he wants to do. He wants to flip folks off on the freeway. He wants to get mad at the waiter or the waitress because my food wasn't done right. That's the flesh man. But we got to take the Spirit man and bring him up. Amen. Build him up. Building ourselves up in this most holy faith. That's what the Bible tells us. We're to be building ourselves up this morning. Amen. Let's bow our hearts. Let's bow our hearts this morning. I don't think there's one person in this room who hasn't been angry with somebody and could say, you know what, my actions, they weren't the best of actions during that time. You know, maybe my words, I said words to hurt somebody. Husbands have hurt wives. Wives have hurt husbands. Children have hurt because of their parents. Be angry and sin not. Jesus says that we are not to call each other names. We're not to put upon each other labels, titles that don't belong. We are all precious in the sight of the Lord this morning. His perfect creatures, created in His image for His glory. And we need to see ourselves as that and see our brothers and sisters, our neighbors, our parents. We need to forgive. Yeah, you might have been hurt. Maybe you were offended. Maybe somebody said something to you, did you wrong last year, yesterday, could have been this morning. You need to let it go. We need to clean the slate this morning. We need to say, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me. I think of these people hearing this message and the Sermon on the Mount, and they're there with Jesus. And I can't help but believe that they're sitting there in that hill, looking at the Lord, His arms wide open, His love being poured out on all people. And that's what He's doing this morning. He's pouring out His love over you this morning. He's pouring out His love over this planet this morning. We got a war being waged across the water. We got wars being waged right here in our own city, in our own homes. Sometimes we got wars that are happening all around us. But we need to reach up and take those arms of love and wrap them around us ourselves this morning. We need to say, Lord, wash my heart this morning. Wash my mind this morning. Wash my way of thinking this morning. Wash my words this morning. Forgive me, God. Forgive me. Forgive me. Lord, if I've offended, we need to be like Zacchaeus. If I've offended anyone, if I've done anyone wrong, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me. Forgive me. And then we need to get right with that person. You've hurt someone, you've spoken about them, maybe you've gossiped about them, you've been talking about them like a dog, and you've been calling them everything and mumbling under your breath. You need to let it go, and you need to go to that person and say, please forgive me. We need to get right with one another. We need to be vehicles of grace this morning, vehicles of mercy today. And that only happens when we allow God's Spirit to reign in us. Father, I pray this morning that your word and your work be done in each one of us today. Forgive us, Lord, for our offenses. Forgive us for our trespasses. Forgive us, Lord, we pray. God, I'm asking you to heal us in our hearts, heal us in our homes, heal us in our nation, heal us with our neighbors, heal us, Lord God, in every situation. I'm asking you to send healing this morning in the name of Jesus, your Son. I'm praying, Lord God, for your people that we have heard your word this morning, that the Holy Spirit's work is doing a great and awesome thing in us of delivering us from this vehicle of anger. We bind the enemy's work in our minds right now and in our hearts, in our homes. And we loose the authority of your word, the word of grace, the word of mercy, the word of healing today, Lord. In Jesus' name. All right, let's stand today. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Turn the stove off. Amen. I know it might be, and if it's a grease fire, get some salt and put on it. Some baking powder. Get some baking powder and put it out too. You know? Don't get some water and throw it in there. Now you're just going to make it fire up even better. And don't get a can of gasoline either. All right? I know some folks want to get gasoline. Yeah, I'm going to show you how hot this thing can get. No, we need to let it go. Amen. Whatever's happening in your home, in your life, get it right today. Amen. That's what God wants us to do. He desires truth in the inward part. Amen. Let us be those people. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I bless each one of you. Let's go have a great week in Jesus Christ. God bless you.